Thank you, most of all, for loving us. And we just sang about the love of God, dear Lord. We thank you for your love, that you loved us enough that you sent Jesus Christ to die in our place on the cross of Calvary. Dear Lord, right now we just ask that you help us to focus in on you. Also, if there's anyone that's watching live streaming that needs to know you as Lord and Savior, dear Lord, just show them they need to be saved. Draw them out to true soul conversion, dear Lord. Dear Lord, be with this message. May it be all of you, none of me. Help us to take your word, apply it to our lives, and grow thereby. And dear Lord, we know that the word of God is what's going to change lives, dear Lord. So may you get the honor, glory, and praise in all said and done here today. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Brand new series, which is 1 Timothy. So open your Bibles to 1 Timothy. And we're going to actually do 1 Timothy 1 and 2, the first two verses this week. So, in 1 Timothy 1 and 2 says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God, unto of our the commandment of God our Savior and the Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope, unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. Which basically, when you do this, it's one of the things that people look at 1 Timothy. It's a handbook on how to run the church. And it's the ultimate handbook of church. So have you ever wanted to have the ultimate handbook of how to do a church? I know that's what everybody's just excited about. Well, this is actually it. It's how we should run a church, what our policies should be, how our practices should be, what should we do to guard the faith, how should we do it. And they're actually 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, and Titus are called the pastoral epistles. And the reason for them are to instruct pastors and churches how to do what they're supposed to do. We don't need to buy the latest, you know, gimme book, the latest fad book on how to run a church, because God already gave us in the Word of God how He wants it done. He also gave us a mission statement in the Bible, too, of what He wants done. So instead of buying the latest book and seeing how to build the next greatest, biggest church, we need to go back to the Word of God and see how does God want His church built. And this just gives credit to the people that called it the pastoral epistles, which was a guy named Bordeaux and another guy named Paul Anton, who back in the 1700s started coining the term pastoral epistles. And these three books are basically the handbook of the policies and practices of the local church. And it's written after Philippians, by the way, since we just finished our series on Philippians. This was written after Philippians, and Paul was in prison at the time of Philippians. He was released from prison at this time, so you can kind of get the context a little bit. And when you build something, you got to lay a foundation. If you build a house, you might want to have a concrete or some type of foundation. You might want to dig some footers. You might want to have a firm foundation when you build a house. Otherwise, if you build a tall building, it may collapse if you don't have a good foundation. Same thing with a series. If we don't build a good foundation, we are not going to have a good series. So you want to put down the foundation. And today is foundational to the rest of the series of 1 Timothy. And it lays that foundation. Paul, we need to know why Paul wrote it. Paul wrote the book of Timothy for one of the reasons, to encourage Timothy. Timothy was a young preacher. He felt like giving up. And Paul encourages him to keep on doing God's will. And sometimes we feel like giving up. Sometimes we're like, is this really worth it? We're beating our head into a wall trying again and again and again to do what is right. But then, is it really worth it? And sometimes we feel like just throwing in the towel, giving up, and quitting. Well, Timothy felt the same way. There's one thing that's great about all the people in the Bible. You know, when you read about them, they are just like us. You know, Elijah was a man of like passions as we are. Yet Elijah called down fire from heaven. It's pretty cool. When you think about these people in the Bible that are used as examples for us, are like us. They had the same feelings, same everything. But then they trusted in the same God and were able to see God do amazing things by trusting God. Timothy felt like giving up. Paul encourages them to keep on going, keep doing what is right. And when we're discouraged, we need people to encourage us. And when we see others discouraged, we need to encourage them. There's a gift of encouragement, but we need to go alongside. When you see somebody that's doing what is right, that's really fighting for what is right, instead of going over there and saying, hey, yeah, you're messing up, you're not getting the job done, go over there and encourage them to keep on fighting. Keep the faith. Keep the fight. Fight for what is right no matter what. Do what you've got to do. Stay in the fight. Don't get discouraged. Keep on going. Because when we're on God's side, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. This is actually one of the times that's accurate. Now I can go, you know, fight a grizzly bear with my bare hands. That's taking the verse out of context. But I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When God's on our side, there's nothing too difficult for God. It may be too difficult for us, but it's not too difficult for Him. So we can see God do amazing things. But we need to encourage others that are in that fight for what is right and go and encourage them. Hey, when you're seeking God and doing what God's got the call on your life, God's got it handled for you. Encourage them, strengthen them. And then when we're the discouraged one, hopefully somebody will do that same thing for us, like Paul did for Timothy in this case. Paul encouraged him to stand to fight for what is right, even though it wasn't easy. And generally when you fight for what is right, it's not easy. And the world doesn't like it when you fight for what is right. Because when you're the light in a dark world, the darkness isn't happy that you showed up their sin and showed up that they're sinful and they're in need of a Savior. They're not going to be too happy with you because you're the light. When you're fighting for what is right, those who are wrong, those who are fighting for what is evil, are going to be mad at those who fight for what is right. So if you encounter opposition, good. Now, if you encounter opposition for doing what is right, good. Let me rephrase it. If you are doing what is right and you encounter opposition, good, because it means you're doing something right. Now, if you encounter opposition because you're doing something wrong, you need to repent, get down to business with God, and start doing what is right. So, but stand up for what is right, fight for what is right, even if it's not easy. And Paul encouraged Timothy to lead a victorious Christian life. How do we do that? By letting the Holy Spirit have full, complete control of our lives and allowing Him to live the Christian life through us. And the only way you can do that is if you have Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Because the Bible says if any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. So to have the Holy Spirit live the Christian life through you, you first got to be saved. And then you can live a victorious Christian life and you can really watch God do some great miracles in our lives. And through Jesus Christ, we have the victory. Now for the context, as we showed like a week or two or three ago, if you take scriptures out of context, you can prove anything and use that. You know, Judas Iscariot went and hung himself, and go and do thou likewise, and whatsoever thou doest, do it quickly. So if you take three verses out of context, you can prove something totally erroneous, that you should go hang yourself. The Bible does not teach that. We don't teach that. But if you take scriptures out of context, you can prove anything. Or the widow cast in her last two mites. Well, she cast in all the money she had, so you need to give all the money you have. And whatsoever thou doest it quickly. And, you know, same thing. You need to give all your money to us and, you know, whatever. You can prove things by taking out of context that the Bible just simply doesn't say. So we need the context. So context of how mail system was in ancient Rome. Paul was sending a letter to Timothy. This letter was written in about the 60s A.D. And today's letters start with dear so-and-so and end with sincerely or your servant or love or however. Because if I wrote to my wife, I'd probably put love your hubby, you know, or whatever. But if I wrote to somebody else, it's a business letter, it would be sincerely whatever. You would end it. We start that way with, you know, who we're addressing at the end, who we are. That's not how it was back in the first century. And that day, the writer would identify themselves. And it starts off Paul. Paul says who he is. First words. This is who's writing the letter. Paul. You know, and then after identifying themselves, they would pronounce a blessing on the recipient. Which we generally don't, may or may not pronounce a blessing on the recipient. In that case, Paul's the writer. And also in the beginning, after they pronounce a blessing, they would say, unto whoever, in this case, Timothy. You know, it tells who the writer is, who the thing is. So in your first about paragraph, you know who the writer is, you know who the recipient is, and you know that there's a blessing of some kind. Because that was just traditionally how they did it. And in this case, it was Timothy was the recipient, but in the broader context, it was all the local churches. Because this is a handbook for the churches. This is how you're supposed to operate. And, you know, it had a purpose in it. And it says, Paul, an apostle. Now, with an apostle, they had to be personally commissioned by Jesus Christ. So, you know, there was the 11 apostles, which, you know, Judas Iscariot went and hung himself, so he was gone. Paul, on the road to Damascus, was personally commissioned by Jesus Christ. And since you had to be personally commissioned by Jesus Christ to be an apostle, guess what? There's no apostles today because you have to be personally commissioned by Jesus Christ to be an apostle. And since Jesus is not coming back till the second coming of Christ, no one will be seeing Jesus to have them personally commission them to be an apostle. And Paul was specially sent by Jesus Christ himself. Acts 9, Acts 22, and Acts 26 all talk about that road to Damascus experience that Paul had. So you can look those up at home. But those are where it's found. Acts 9, Acts 22, and Acts 26. And by the, it says, Paul, an apostle, by the commandment, it was not an option. You know, when Paul, God said, hey, Paul, here's what you're going to do. Paul didn't get to say, hey, let me think about this. Let me check this out. Whatever. When God calls you to do something, it's not an option. You cannot say no and call him Lord. You have to say yes, Lord. Because if he's truly Lord of your life, that means he's your master. He is in control. If he's in control, you got to say yes, Lord. Not no, Lord. Because if you say no, he's not your Lord. So you don't tell God no. You say yes, Lord. So when God called you to do his will, his way, you say yes, Lord. Go, be available, be willing to go. Go where God calls you. And if God tells you to bloom where you're planted, bloom where you're planted. But do exactly what God's called you to do in life. Don't do anything outside his will, because then when you step outside of his will, it says, for whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. So don't get under the chastisement of God. Be in the will of God. Be in the blessings of God. Be walking in the light as he is in the light. And it says, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So do what God's got called for you in life and say, yes, Lord. When God calls you to do something, yes, Lord. Immediately respond. Because when the disciples, when they responded, he says, follow me. Immediately they left the nets and followed him. There was no hesitation. There was no stopping. There's no whatever. They dropped what they were doing and followed Christ. When God calls us to do something, we need to do it immediately and say, yes, Lord. Because commandments are not options. And Paul did not choose to be an apostle. God called him to it. So it's not like you choose to be what you are. God calls you to it. So find out what God's got for you in your life, find your calling, and do your calling. And then it says, by the commandment of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, as we just pointed out, means master. Christ is the Greek for the word Mashiach, which is Hebrew, or Messiah. He's also Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And in Luke 2, it says, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. He's all three, by the way. He was all three in the manger. He was all three at this point. He's all three in heaven. He's Savior. When we turn from our sins and receive Jesus Christ as our personal Lord and Savior, he saves us. He redeems us from the slave market of sin for the purpose of setting us free. He's Savior. He's Lord. Means he's our master. He tells us what to do. Now we belong to Jesus. Why? Because he purchased us with his own blood. We now belong to him. He's our Lord. He's our master. He's also the Christ. He's the Messiah. He is the one that came, the spotless Lamb of God, to take away the sins of the world. And he paid for our sins with his precious blood. So he's our Lord, our Savior, and our Master, and our King, and Prophet, and a whole bunch of other things that the Bible mentions. But literally, he's the Christ, the Messiah Jesus, is how it puts it in the Greek. He's the Messiah Jesus. And it goes, Paul, an apostle by the commandment of the Lord Jesus Christ, to Timothy. Now Timothy, his name means he who honors God. We chose that middle name for my son. He who honors God. Timothy was a person that strove to honor God in his life. So it fit who he was. As a pastor, he tried to honor God. And it says, then the next part says, God our Savior and of Christ Jesus our hope. Well, God our Savior. Now this has go back to the context of Rome. In Rome, the term Savior was used of the Greek and Roman gods, and it was also used of the emperor. So it had some connotation there. And designating God as the Savior, therefore makes it clear that salvation comes from God and not from Greek pagan gods, from the Roman pagan gods, or from the emperor, but from God of heaven. God alone is where salvation comes from. So that's why Paul used it here, is to differentiate between their pagan system and the truth of God's word. And it's God who sets us free from sin and its penalty. And since Jesus paid the penalty for our sins, here on earth, died, was buried, and rose again, we have a future in heaven and can experience his kingdom here on earth. Hopefully you realize you can experience God's kingdom here on earth, because we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. If any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he's not of his. So once you're saved, you have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. You can have kingdom of heaven here on earth. Now, I don't agree with your best life now, because this is not our best life now. Our best life is in heaven. But you can experience the very kingdom of God here on earth if you allow the Holy Spirit to control your life. If you allow God to have full, complete control of your life, you can experience him here. It says, Jesus is our hope. Of course he is. Because without him, we would be lost. Without Jesus, we would be nothing. But because of Jesus, we have an eternal home in heaven. We have a future. We have a hope. And this epistle or letter is written to Timothy, who is a young pastor, and he was at Ephesus. You know about the book of Ephesians. This is the pastor of Ephesus for a while. And Paul was the veteran of Christian service, writing a letter of instruction to a newer, younger pastor. Probably from things I've read, Timothy was either in the late 20s, early 30s when he was at this point. So he's a younger pastor. Paul, who is the veteran, is writing to the younger guy, trying to encourage him. And the principles in this book are key for our church and for all New Testament churches that are God-centered to follow. Because not all churches that claim to be churches are God-centered. But if you're God-centered, this is what we should follow, because this is what God said to do. And when God says it, we should do exactly what God tells us to. And he says, after Timothy, he says, my own son of the faith. Timothy was saved under the ministry of Paul. When Paul was going through Lystra and Derbe and that area, and also went through Philippi on that missionary trip, but one of the people that got saved was Timothy. And then he took Timothy under his wing, he discipled him, he mentored him. And that's what's lacking in a lot of churches, is we don't disciple and mentor our new converts. We need to take, when somebody's saved, we need to take them under our wing, we need to disciple them, train them up, mentor them, teach them how to be a better follower of Jesus Christ. And also, word disciple means learner. So we teach them how they need to learn the things of God. And what better way to do than by demonstrating for them and teaching them. So we need to teach them the word of God. And it says, Acts 16:1 says, then he came to Derbe and Lystra, and behold, a certain disciple was there named Timotheus, or Timothy, the son of a certain woman, which was a Jew, and believed, but his father was a Greek. So his mom's Jewish, his father's Greek. But Timothy was saved under the ministry of Paul. And then at home you can do Acts 16, read through that entire chapter and see more about that first missionary journey. An interesting fact is Acts 16 is also where they started the Church of Philippi. Church of Philippi had this great meeting complex called the River. They met down by a river. So it doesn't matter where the called out church of saints assemble. What matters is the saints get together and worship God. That's what matters. Because some churches, they worship the building they're in. We need to worship the God who is actually in our hearts, who died on the cross of Calvary. We need to exalt Jesus Christ, not our building, not our location, not whatever. We exalt Jesus Christ in our lives. And he, by the way, if you talk about Jesus Christ with your lips, your life needs to show it. And then this is Daniel Aiken, who's actually president of the seminary over, I think, in South Carolina, says, during Paul's missionary journeys, he entrusted Timothy with assignments to the churches at Thessalonica, which is 1 Thessalonians 3, 1 through 10, to Corinth, 1 Corinthians 4, 16 and 17, Philippi, which is in Philippians 2, 19 to 24, and it says he also assisted in six of Paul's extant letters, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, Timothy's mentioned, 2 Corinthians, Colossians, Philippians, Philemon. Paul was a highly trusted associate of Paul. He was like Paul's right-hand man for a long time. Paul, we also know about Paul and Silas. We know Paul had other people that really helped with his ministry. But Timothy's one of these great guys that was used mightily of God in the ministry of Paul. And then it goes, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, which is that blessing we were talking about. Grace, charis, goodwill, loving kindness, favor, especially of the spiritual blessings that come from God. And then the next is mercy.
which is aleos, compassion. Instead of giving us what we deserve, God has compassion on us. He has mercy on us because of Jesus Christ's free gift of salvation. So we don't get what we deserve. And then grace, this is a quote, I couldn't find who the author of this was, but it says, grace is when God gives us what we don't deserve, and mercy is when God doesn't give us what we do deserve. And I like that quote, so I put it in there. But that is so true. God doesn't give us what grace is when God doesn't give us what we don't deserve, and mercy is when God doesn't give us what we do deserve. Peace, irene, true peace only comes from having a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, because we are reconciled to God, and then now we have peace with God because we are reconciled to God because of the blood of Jesus Christ, because Christ washes away our sins, washes away the practice, the penalty of our sins. The Hebrew greeting, by the way, was shalom. When they used to say hello, we'd say hi, how you doing, hello. They used to say shalom, peace, referring to the peace of the Messiah. So when he's saying irene, which is Greek, that's the Greek word for shalom. He's wishing them peace, the peace of the Messiah, and the peace with God that comes through the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And Jesus is the Messiah. By the way, this book is divinely inspired. This epistle comes from God, though he used Paul to write it. God the Father, even the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's who authored this letter. God is our Father because we have been adopted into his forever family because of Jesus Christ. When you have adoption, somebody's adopted into the family. They become part of your forever family. They never leave your family. They're never going to be anything but your family. If we adopt a kid into our family, they're adopted into our forever family. They become just like my blood and flesh, my own son, who is blood and flesh. The adopted one is now equal to that, because, and we're adopted into the family of God because of Jesus Christ. We become joint heirs with Jesus. That is what we become, because Jesus Christ died in our place, and we are now able to enter into the family of God. So once you're saved, you are adopted into the forever family of God. And God is now our Father. Instead of God the Father, God is our Father. So it's really, really cool that we become part of the family of God because of Jesus Christ. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine or teaching, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So all scripture is given by inspiration of God. So this book, this letter to Timothy, is actually given by inspiration of God. And 2 Peter 1:21 says, whoop, it just went away. Let's try and bring it back. For the prophecy that came in old time came not in old time by the will of man, but the holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. God told the writers what to write. So God was telling Paul what to write in the book of 1 Timothy. So this book has divine inspiration. This is divinely inspired by God. Since God said it, we need to pay attention. When God tells you something, you need to stand up and listen. When my mom used to say something growing up, you used to kind of need to pay attention, because my mom and my dad had different ways of disciplining. My mom's way of disciplining, whatever you did wrong, that discipline fit. My dad just was simply spanking. My mom's, she made the discipline fit whatever you did. Now, I feared my mom's way of discipline, because she made it fit and you learned a lesson each time. And boy, you didn't want to make that mistake again. Anyway, it's kind of interesting. One time I made her so mad she didn't talk to me for 3 days. That 3 days of her not talking to me was worse than the actual discipline, because I knew my mom also would not discipline in anger. So my mom not disciplining in anger, it took her 3 days to get over being mad at me. I knew I really messed up. Anyway, but when my mom would tell me something, you would do it. Why? Because she meant what she said. When God tells us to do something, he means what he said. That's where the word of God is divinely inspired. God told these men what to write. They wrote what God told them what to write. We are to take the commands of God and do what God says. God's not playing around. When he gives us a command, he expects us to do it. He
He expects us to be obedient, just as my mom used to expect me to be obedient. Boy, did I prove her wrong on that. But then also she showed me what chastisement was. In a good form. I learned how to be a good parent, actually, by watching the example of my mom. The Holy Spirit told Paul what to write, and he did. So Paul did exactly what the Holy Spirit told him. And for further context, we need to look at it. Why was it written? It was written to Timothy to be an example for others on how God desires his church to operate. He was telling Timothy, specifically, Timothy, here's how you need to operate in a church. Here's how you need to be a pastor. But then it was in a broader context telling all churches how to operate, how the pastors need to operate, how the churches need to operate, what we need to do to be effective in reaching souls for Jesus Christ. Because that's the purpose of the church, is to see souls saved and transformed into believers. We want to see people one to Jesus Christ. This world with all its problems, what's the problem with this world? Sin. What's the answer for sin? Jesus Christ. So we can see this world's problems go away if people would turn from their sins and receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So the church is how God orchestrated for that to occur. It's by a group of called out believers getting together, worshiping him. Now we get together, what, to edify each other, to build each other up, to strengthen each other in Christ. So we can go out and live victorious Christian lives and see souls saved and see lives transformed to the glory of God. That is the purpose of a church. And that is why Paul was writing to Timothy, so churches could be established. And one of the purposes is to protect the gospel. Because when there's error in the church, if you were going to poison somebody, by the way, I'm not recommending anyone poison anyone, but if you were going to poison somebody, would you take arsenic and hand them a bottle of arsenic and say, hey, drink the arsenic, that's going to poison you? What's the person going to do? Going to say, you're nuts. Well, they probably think we're nuts anyways. But, or if you cooked a nice, beautiful cake and said, here, I made you a nice piece of cake, and you make it look so good, and it's only got like 3% arsenic, it's still going to kill you. But one way, it's appetizing and it's appealing. Well, that's what the devil does to sin, and how he perverts the gospel. He makes it look so close to the real thing, but he puts a little bit of poison in there. Because he doesn't want to see souls saved, but he wants to trick people into going to hell. Because the devil doesn't play fair. He uses lies and deception. So it's trickery. So that's why we need to know what the truth is. Because when you know what the truth is, it reveals the error. And that's why Paul wants Timothy to fight the good fight of faith, to conduct himself in a manner worthy of the gospel, so he can keep the truth of the gospel, that salvation is in Jesus Christ alone. It's not in walking a church aisle. It's not in shaking a preacher's hand. It's not in repeating this little prayer after me and being pronounced saved, because, by the way, the only Holy Spirit can lead you in that prayer. A person telling you what to say and you're repeating it, well, you're placing your faith in somebody's man-made contrivance, that's error. The truth is that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins, paid for our sins, was buried, and rose again. And when you ask Jesus Christ into your heart, the Holy Spirit gives you what to say. You don't need to repeat somebody else's little prayer. You don't need to be baptized to be saved, because the thief found the cross. Never baptized. He's in heaven today. So you don't have to. It's salvation of faith, not of works, lest any man should boast, as Ephesians 2:8-9 says. So Paul wanted Timothy to fight the good fight, keep the truth of the gospel, keep the truth that salvation is in Jesus Christ alone through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And if your faith is resting on anything other than Jesus Christ, you're not saved. If your faith is totally based on what Jesus Christ did on the cross, that's where salvation is, because it's based on what he did, not based on what we did. In the new life of the new church, this book lays some foundational groundwork. And in an established church, this great reminders of how the basics are. Because back to the basics. When somebody's in baseball, what do? They take them back to the basics. Football, back to the basics. Here's how you throw a block. Here's how you do this with the football. They take you back to the very basics of the thing. Keep your eye on the ball, as they say in baseball. Keep your eye on the ball. Why? Just back to the basics. With churches, we need to go back to the basics. Why did God have us go back to the basics? Why did God put this out here? So we would be effective in reaching souls for Jesus Christ. That's why. And the church's mission statement, given by Jesus Christ, is go or as literally as you are going, therefore make disciples of all nations. Excuse me, all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things which I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. That is our mission statement. Churches sometimes have different ones. They have connect, grow, serve, or they have love God, love people, serve God by serving people. Or they take this verses and they restate it a ton of different ways. But this is the mission statement given to the church by God. We don't have to go buy the latest, greatest fad book to figure out what the mission statement is of our church. God gave it to us in the Bible, in the book of Matthew. So we don't have to guess what it is. 1 Timothy is practical application of the administration of Christ's church here on earth. So that is what 1 Timothy is. And that's one reason why I'm so excited about this series, is because we get to see from God how he wants his church done. And by the way, a disciple is first a person who has received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Because it says we're supposed to make disciples. So if we're supposed to be out there making disciples, wouldn't it be a good idea to know what a disciple is? I think it would be. Because how can you make something if you don't know what they are? And then a disciple is a person who follows Jesus Christ. They're a follower of Jesus Christ. They're a learner. They learn about Jesus Christ. They follow him. They take the word of God. They apply it to their lives and follow Jesus Christ. By the way, if we want people to follow Jesus Christ, we can never lead somebody where we first won't go ourselves. So we have to be a follower of Jesus Christ. We have to do what Christ says. We have to find out what God's calling is on our life and do it. And then once we find God's calling on our life and do it, then we can lead others to find God's calling on their life and they can do it. And then as we lead others to Jesus Christ, they get saved, they become disciples, we mentor them, they grow up in Christ, they lead others to Jesus Christ. And the cycle continues, and we see people saved, and we see lives transformed, and we see nations changed for Jesus Christ, but it comes through us first. If you ever want to see revival, there's a simple way, and I forget which gentleman said this, but he goes, if you ever want to see revival, go into your prayer closet or go into your room or someplace quiet. He says, draw a circle on the floor, and then he goes, says, go stand in the middle of that circle, and then pray, God, revive everybody within the circle. So before you pray revival for the nation of America, we need to pray revive me. And then in a few weeks, we're going to have National Day of Prayer. By the way, prayer will be down on the square. We will have. There's also going to be prayer over in Denell, and there's going to be prayer around the county, prayer probably all over the state and all of the nation. But there's going to be Day of Prayer. But, and we'll hear this quoted, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and heal their land. But we always say, they always want our land to be healed, but no one wants the first part, which is if my people, which are those people who have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, if my people who are called by my name, Christians, little Christ, will humble themselves. How many of us are humble? Are we humble and realizing that it's not us, it's all about God, it's not about us? Will humble themselves and pray, which prayer, National Day of Prayer, and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. It's not about the wacko liberals turning from their wicked ways, or the people over in another country, China, needs to turn from their wicked ways, or people in wherever, whatever, Zimbabwe, who knows what country, need to turn from their wicked ways. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways. When we turn, as Christians, turn from sinning, from serving sin and self to really truly following Jesus Christ and live in life of holiness, separation from sin, and we seek God that way, then he's going to hear from heaven. So we need to pray, God, revive me. Make me who you would have me to be, not who I want to be. It's not about us. It's about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. It's about exalting him. And a disciple is someone who learns that, becomes a follower of Jesus Christ. We're a follower first, as Pastor Rusty Ricketson at Luther Rice says. We're a follower first of Jesus Christ. Then after we follow Jesus Christ, then we can lead others to Jesus Christ. When we lead others to Jesus Christ, they become followers. They can lead others to Jesus Christ, and we can see revival break out in America. But we need to be revived first. It needs to be us first. And have you turned from your sins and self and receive Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Because if you haven't, then the rest of this stuff really doesn't apply, because you need Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior to be saved, to spend eternity in heaven. And we all have sinned, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. If you don't believe me, thou shalt not lie. If you told a lie, you're a liar. As we were talking actually before the service, me and Miss Kelly were talking about this, and you know, Kirk Cameron does this, but you tell one lie, you're a liar. You steal something, you're a thief. So if you've lied, by your own admission, you're a liar. If you've stolen something, you're a thief, so you're a lying thief. And you can go through the Ten Commandments, and you've broken one, guaranteed. And if you go through all the commandments of the Bible and say you haven't broken any of them, I guarantee one thing, you're lying. So we are all sinners, and when it takes one sin to make you a sinner, just like it takes one murder to make you a murderer, it takes one sin to make you a sinner, and what do we do? The wages of sin is death. It means we're going to spend eternity forever in a place called hell that was made for the devil and his angels, but we, by our own sinful actions, have earned that spot. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. So when we turn from our sins and self and receive Jesus Christ, the free gift of salvation, which we did nothing to earn, but we received that free gift of salvation, we're saved based on what he did, not based on what we did. So have you turned from your sins and received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? If you have, does your life reflect Jesus? If you were put on trial for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Could anyone tell that you're a Christian? When you're out there sharing Jesus Christ with this lost and dying world, does your life match what your lips say? Is there evidence that you live for Jesus Christ? Can people see Jesus in you? If they can't see Jesus in you, you might want to go back and check to make sure you're truly converted. Because we need to repent and be converted that our sins are blotted out. Repent means we completely turn from. We turn from sin itself to Jesus Christ. And then if anyone watching on Facebook Live has not done that, please, you can instant message me on Facebook Live. You can instant message probably anyone in our church. And we will show you from the Bible how you can know beyond a shadow of a doubt. If you died today, you'd spend eternity in heaven. Also, it's real easy. I think we went through it. Turn from sin and self and ask Jesus Christ to be your Lord and Savior. It's real simple. He's there for the asking. And with that, I'll close in a word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for all you've given us, Lord God. Thank you most of all for loving us and dying on the cross for our sins and paying for our sins with your precious blood, Lord God. May you get the honor, glory, and praise in all we say and do here today, dear Lord. And dear Lord, if anyone that's watching this does not know you as Lord and Savior, just show them their need to be saved. Draw them out to true soul conversion, dear Lord. And dear Lord, be with each person that attended here today. Just pour out a blessing on each one. And dear Lord, also be with Miss Bobby, who's under the weather. Be with Miss Opal. Be with all the other ones that are on our prayer list, dear Lord, that just need a healing touch from you, dear Lord. May you just touch them and be with them and help them in each situation, dear Lord. May you get the honor, glory, and praise in all we say and do. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And we will sing the doxology for our closing hymn.